to the Well. If it's your first time, welcome. We're so glad you're here. If you're joining us online, we're so glad you're watching from there too. So if you'd like to stand with us, we're going to get started with worship. You'll see we have a rather small team today. I'm thankful for Julia here on the guitar and Jeff there on the drums. Let's worship the Lord together.
Stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us.
Thank you, Lord.
Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
The battle belongs to him. Real quick, these lights are going to come up in the back. We like to say good morning and hello to each other here at the Well. So maybe meet someone new today or wave from afar if you're not too comfortable. Say, welcome to the Well. All right. Okay. Well, if you guys would like to have a seat real quick, it's actually time for announcements. So, little change of pace today. Everybody say, what's up to Mike Potter. Woo!
Good morning. I guess this, there we go. Last service, I stood over here, and then I thought about it, and I was like, kind of weird. So, I just want to say welcome to everybody that's here and anyone that's online. Thanks for joining us. We're really glad you're here. If you're a first time here, you know, thank you. Thank you for coming, checking us out. Please come back again. Also, if you grab one of these inside of there, there is a connection card, a giving envelope. Don't feel like you have to give if you're, you know, first time here, but of course, if you want to, feel free. One thing, growth groups start today. So if you haven't signed up for one, find one. It's really good. I mean, April and I, we got a lot from the growth groups we've been in over the years. Personal growth, relationship growth, friendships, everything. So please, please join one. Just have a good time. Also, we're going to bring Tiffany up. She has some stuff to talk about kids ministry. So come on up.
And Andrew.
Good dance, Andrew. Good dance. Yeah.
My name is Tiffany. This is my second time being up here for announcements. First was this morning. I'm also known as Andrew's mom. So I am here to tell you guys that this year, this Easter, the Well is going to be taking part in the Sidewalk Gospel. We'll be using chalk to teach and share the good news of Jesus. And we want you guys to partner with us to color the sidewalks of Modesto. We're going to have kits available starting next week. So you can pick up kits. They'll have instructions. We want you to take any kits that you have, if you're an aunt, uncle, grandma, grandpa, mom, neighbor. Set up play dates and then take those kids, and we're going to color the sidewalks sharing the gospel. And there's instructions and there's lessons on how we can do that. We want you to take pictures, share them with your social media, and tag us, the Well Kids Men, in those posts, and you'll be entered into a drawing for a prize for Easter. Yeah, I don't want to give away the prizes because I'm not sure if I'm supposed to, but it's pretty cool. Yeah, so chalk it, snap it, share it, and hashtag it. That's what we want you to do. The kits will be available starting next week, and then they'll be available the 13th, 20th, and 27th for you guys to pick up. Thank you.
E.
All right, thanks, Tiffany. All right, April, thank you.
All right, great job, guys. Tiffany and Michael, didn't they do a good job? It is like nerve-wracking to be up here, so... just so you know, you guys did great. We're going to continue on in worship. If you'd like to stand with us, let's let Julius lead us in a few more songs.
So hard to see it, took me so long to believe it, that you choose someone like me to carry your victory. Perfection could never earn it, I get what we don't. Glory, you are my child.
Champion. And then we get to be seated right alongside the living God that has conquered it all. Our battles that we've already been able to give to you, you are victorious, Father. And we claim that in the name of Jesus, that we get to stand alongside that victory. Let us remember that when we're going through those valleys, Father, to keep our eyes on you. Because at the end of it, you are victorious. Remind us to lead us to the cross, Father.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember, redemption's hill where your blood was spilled. For
Father God, let us be led to your cross in every moment, Father. Let us turn our heads to you. Let us lift our eyes to the one who sees us, who knows us. Father, let us stand with you. Thank you for being a part of what we're doing here at the Well. And we just pray that you're honored by today, by our interactions with one another, by the worship, by the message. Father, thank you for allowing us to be just a small part of what you're doing. And I thank you for today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you guys, so we have been attacked, just so you know, by Satan. And I'm going to tell you, he is not going to win. So poor Jeremy, our bass player, broke his thumb last night, right? Oh, that's already too bad, right? I know. Well, Pastor Tim decided he wanted to, like, fall down at his house and, fell and hit his head and had to go to the ER and get stitches. And he was severely dehydrated, so he is doing better. They rehydrated him, thankfully. Kevin and Jessica are in Hawaii. So all this is happening, and we're like, that's okay. You're not going to win. Look, I got these guys. And then we were blessed enough to get Kevin to get this man, David Wood. Thank you, Pastor David from Shelter Cove. And he's going to come and deliver a great message. We just thank you so much for being here, especially last minute. And that our God is victorious, and we get to say that. So thanks for being
Amen.
Here.
Amen. Yes. Yeah. All right. Hi, everybody. My name is David. Like she said, I'm from Shelter Cove. And I didn't grow up here. I don't know why I said I grew up. I wasn't even going to say that at all. I used to live down by Johansson High School. I live out in Oakdale currently with my wife and my four children, which is so many kids. It's a lot of kids. I'm tired all the time. But it's a privilege to be able to share the word of God, and it's an honor for me to be able to be here with you guys today. So thank you for letting me come and be a part of this. But as I was talking with Kevin last night about what we kind of were thinking the Lord was wanting to share with you all, Kevin mentioned that last week he talked about serving, and he said that you guys all had such a great response and that your church is so excited to be able to jump in and serve the people in the community and be the hands and feet of Jesus. And I think that's such a beautiful thing. And as the church is kind of working with you guys to put you in places where you get to be that, I think a great place to start is just talking about how we can love people. And how we love them is really the first step in serving people. So I want to share with you guys about loving and serving people. You know, over the past 3 years, this country has been more divided than I have ever experienced it in my life. We have the Democrats versus Republicans. We have the vaxxers versus the anti-vaxxers. And you guys are already starting to get uncomfortable, and you're like, he's their new guy. And I think of all of the divisive and polarizing opinions in the world, I think few would be greater than the Great Chicken Sandwich War of 2019. It was huge, right? Popeyes brought out their new chicken sandwich, and it was wonderful. It was fantastic. Chick-fil-A exists, and it's all right. But this thing, and then people's like, Burger King, what are you doing bringing out a chicken sandwich? Anyways, all jokes aside, though, there are some genuinely serious social issues that are divisive, and it's easy to get set up in this place where if you're either one side or the other, and it's easy to get labeled as an other. It's easy to be someone who thinks differently and maybe on that side of things. And it's almost impossible for us to win. No matter what side we choose, we're wrong because someone will tell us we're wrong and why we're wrong. And we can be tagged as this other, or maybe we're quick to tag people as other. And maybe we're quick to say that they're wrong and tell them why they're wrong. And maybe we're quick to point the finger and tell people that they're the other. And before you know it, we have this Spider-Man meme of us all just pointing each other, saying that they're the issue, when really no one is taking the time to listen and hear the stories and talk to people and understand where people are coming from. In the Bible times, there were others as well. We're going to talk about one in Luke chapter 10. If you've got your Bibles with me, with you, turn to Luke chapter 10. Jesus tells the story in Luke chapter 10 about an other, and it doesn't go the way that you would expect. It doesn't go the way that people really thought it was going to go. He was talking with a whole bunch of religious leaders when he shared about this. So if you don't have your Bibles, the words are going to be up on the screen as well. Luke chapter 10, starting in verse 25, it says this. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" he replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You've answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this, and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who's my neighbor?" One way to look at this is the guy was trying to figure out who he needed to love. But I think based on the intent of this man's heart, I think more likely it's easier to read as who am I supposed to love, and who is it okay if I don't love? Who can I put into the box of people that I'm supposed to care for? And who can I keep out of my box and say that they're just other or different? So he says, "Who's my neighbor?" And in reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. And when he was attacked by robbers, they stripped him of his clothes. They beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be walking down the same road. And when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. And so too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, he passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan," and that's the other, right? That's the other. That's the person who was labeled in that time as somebody who was the outcast. Samaritans, they were descendants of the Jews, but they had mixed with people of pagan nations. Something that was specifically forbidden from God. The Israelites have their plan that God has for them, and he wanted to keep them separate from the other nations. But they mixed, and they had kids with these other nations, and because of that, they were shunned. They were rejected. And not only that, but for the last 200 years, from the time of Jesus, for 200 years before that, there were violent outbursts between the Samaritans and the Israelites. There was a full-on race war that was going on between these two groups of people. So when Jesus said that a Samaritan came along, they probably were thinking, "I bet he finished the job. I bet the Samaritan came on and just whatever." But that's not how it happens. Read with me. He says this, "And as he traveled, he came where the man was. And when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn." He brought him to an inn. Sorry, my computer just died on me there. My notes went away. Brought him to an inn. Next day, took him. Where am I? At the top? Innkeeper 4. I can't find it. The man put it on his donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. I'm sorry. took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. "Look after them," he said. "And when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense that you may have." Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert of the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told them, "Go and do likewise." My notes are back. There was this full-fledged race war between these two people groups, the Jewish people and the Samaritans, and racism towards each other was culturally accepted and even celebrated among the people. So not only did Jesus reference the Samaritan, but Jesus positioned the Samaritan as the hero of the story, which is unheard of. That's wild. And this bold decision, it was intentional in this parable. And because the priest and the Levite, they represented the pillars of the Jewish society. And they were meant to reflect the God-honoring love that God displays to his people. And they failed to do so. But a Samaritan, a victim of racism and hate, he embodied the love of God. Friends, it is a dangerous place for us to be in if we find ourselves where we're assuming that every single Christian looks like us, thinks like us, and worships like us. And this parable, it's a reminder that God's love is embodied in people that are different from you, and even people that we may intentionally avoid. Every word of this story is a glimpse at the heart of Jesus and how he wants us to live and love in a world that is plagued with divisiveness, in a world that is filled with darkness. This parable of the Good Samaritan, it gives us the ABCs of loving others. The ABCs. The first, the A, is to be aware. We must be aware. In verse 33 of this story, it says, "And when he saw him," the Samaritan had to see him, right? If the Samaritan was walking along with his head down, just kind of doing his own thing, he wouldn't have noticed, but he was aware. I played football in high school. I played safety. That means I was on, when we didn't have the ball, I was in the very back, and I just got to watch the play and read and make adjustments. One time, the offense, they ran a sweep where the quarterback tossed it to this guy running around the outside, and I saw it coming, and I knew it, so I just made a beeline for where he was going to be, and I was running. I was watching the running back, and I was so focused on what was happening right here that I missed out on what was important. And you can see this in film. The film was following the running back, and you see me going, I'm slow, so I got out of the camera. But I missed, and if you played football, you know the wide receiver on a sweep comes in on a crack block. And he was coming in, and you see the receiver. I go out of frame. You see the receiver go out of frame, and then you see my feet go back into the frame. I got knocked horizontal up into the air, and I fell down, and I get up, and like I'm looking around, and people are green, and I'm like, people shouldn't be green. This isn't how it's supposed to happen. And I was so focused on this, what was happening right in front of me, that I missed. I didn't keep my eyes open, and I missed what was really important. I think that we can live our lives with our heads in our phones or in our books or in our movies. Or if we're just being really honest, we can just be so obsessed and concerned with what's happening in our own lives that we just miss what's happening in the lives of the people right next to us. Jesus modeled being aware of people around him perfectly. You guys remember the story of Zacchaeus? He was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in a sycamore tree, right? Because he wanted to see Jesus. The story goes that Jesus was walking down the street and the crowds were surrounding him. He was beginning to gain more and more fame, and people were like clamoring around him. But Zacchaeus, he couldn't see over the people, and he was trying to get to see Jesus. So he decides to climb into this tree so that he just wanted to look at him, which is a fascinating. I wonder, I think that's something that we can forget, to look at Jesus and just to admire him. But anyways, that was just for me just then. But he climbed into that tree just to look at Jesus, and Jesus, surrounded by crowds, hundreds of people walking around him, Jesus paused in Luke chapter 19 and verse 5. He says this, "And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, 'Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today.'" Jesus modeled being aware of people perfectly. He did three things very, very well. The first thing that he did is he saw Zacchaeus. And if we want to be aware of people, we must see them. We must see them. The Bible says that he looked up. He saw Zacchaeus. He looked up. He saw them. If we are going to be the people who are aware of the needs of people around us, we got to be able to see them. That means the holy huddles that we have in our little spaces, we need to be able to look beyond what we're used to, beyond what we're comfortable with, and go and look for people who are hurting. Look for people that often the church has declared as other, and we must see them. But if we just see them, that's not quite enough, because the next thing we need to do is we need to know them. Jesus said, "Zacchaeus." He said his name. He knew Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was a tax collector. Zacchaeus was an other in that society as well. He was people that people hated, but Jesus knew him. I'm a student pastor at Shelter Cove, and one of the things that is just one of the most important things about my job is to get to know the kids' names. If I don't know their names, I don't know them, because their names are who they are, right? And if I don't know their names, they won't want to tell me their stories. We need to be able to know their names, and in order to know them, we have to listen. And anyone who's been married or been in marriage counseling, might, like me, you know that there's a difference between hearing and listening. You have to really hear them. Listen to their stories, hear what's going on in their lives, put yourselves into their shoes for a moment and take a step outside of what we're going through and recognize that we need to know them. Not necessarily in a place where we're just going to try to correct them or fix them, but just listen and hear what they have to go through or what they've gone through in their life. So we see them, we know them, and then the last point is to reach them. Jesus, right there, he invited himself over to Zacchaeus' house. He said, Zacchaeus, come down. I'm going to come over. That's wild to me. That's so crazy that he invited himself over to that house. He took time to build a relationship. If we want to be aware of the others, we need to be willing to invite them into our lives. And we need to be willing to step into their lives, to meet them in their mess. Whatever the thing that they're going through is, whatever the challenge or the sin struggle or whatever it is, we need to step out into their space and be with them. We need to reach them. So if you want to be aware of people, we must see them, we must know them, we must reach them. And being aware of someone, it's recognizing that they are made in the image of God and that they deserve honor and that they deserve dignity. And then it's treating them like that. It's as simple as that. We have to be aware of people if we want to love like Jesus. The B in the ABCs of compassion is we must be bold. Verse 34, back with the Good Samaritan, it says, he went to him, he bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Oil and wine costs a lot of money nowadays and back then. You guys do the diffusers? That oil, oh man, that's a lot of money. Not only that, but he put the man on his donkey, he took him to an inn, he paid for his stay at the end, and anything extra that needed to be done, he gave all of that. The Good Samaritan did all of that for him. It was a bold action for that Samaritan to do something like that. It was bold for him to do that. It costed him a lot. And friends, if we are going to be bold for Jesus, it's going to cost us as well. When you open your eyes and really, truly are aware of the people in their mess, right where they are, people who are different than you, people who look different, who think different, who sin different, when you see people for who they are, you no longer look at them as other. We don't see them as people, us versus them type of situation. We see them as individuals created by God, deserving of dignity and honor. And then you're offered a choice. And the choice is simply this. It's you can either be bold and love them well, or you can pretend like you don't see them. And I think sometimes we choose to not see them. Let me speak to the Christian in the room tonight. God did not give you a spirit of fear, but of love and power and a strong mind. You have been given everything you need to be bold for Jesus and to go love people. He has given you that power. If we are going to love people that are different from us, then we must be bold, and he's given us the strength to be bold. And what I mean by that is, as you're walking with Jesus, he's going to ask things of you that are challenging to what you desire. He's going to challenge the way that you see people when you walk down the street. He's going to challenge the way, and he's going to ask you to do things to make yourselves just a little bit uncomfortable. Jesus is such a good example of boldness. What comes to my mind is the Last Supper. The Last Supper, Jesus was about to die. He tells his friends that. He gets all of his best friends together and he says, hey guys, this is going to happen. And they didn't understand it. They didn't know what was going on. And then he tells everybody that Peter was going to deny him. And then he tells everybody that Judas was going to betray him. That was a rough dinner party. That would have been so awkward to be sitting there with people, those people like that. And then in this amazing act of selflessness and boldness, Jesus gets up from the table. He takes off his outer garments and he kneels down and he washes his disciples' feet. He washed Judas's feet, knowing what was going to happen. And I contend to you today that there is nothing more bold than to wash the feet of the person you know who is going to get you killed. If Jesus was bold enough to do that, then friends, we have no excuse. We must serve people. Our posture should look like that of Christ Jesus, ready to wash the feet of whoever crosses our paths, ready to love and ready to be bold and courageous to the people who look and talk and sin differently than us. So first, we're aware. Next, we're bold. And the C is compassionate. Verse 33, in the story of the Good Samaritan, it says, he had compassion. And compassion is the care for people who are suffering, but it goes beyond care. It goes beyond just this affection feeling, but it's a feeling, it's something inside of us that draws us and pulls us to act on the behalf of the person that we have compassion for. God the Father, he displayed the greatest act of compassion ever recorded in the history of the world. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. That is compassion. That is love that forces you to action. God the Father loved you so much that he sent his son to die for us. It was God's love for you. It was his compassion for you that led him to send Jesus to bring us back to him. If we see somebody and our heart is not stirred, if we have compassion for somebody and we see them where they're at and our heart is not stirred with compassion for our souls, then there may be a little bit of heart work that we need to do with God. There may be something that you need to work out in your own life. If you see somebody who is struggling or difficult in a difficult life situation, and we aren't led to them in love to walk with them, and not in the business of behavior modification, but in the business of saying, hey, listen, there's Jesus, and he's better, and he's good, and he has a life for you, and then walking with them. And then when they fall, we pick them back up, and we dust them off, and we get back at it, and we walk with Jesus. John actually had more harsh words than I do for that. In 1 John 4:20, it says, if anyone says, I love God, and he hates his brother, he's a liar. That's convicting. That's hard for me even, because I think about the times in my life where I have not done the things that I know that God has called me to do. And I think about the times in my life where I've failed to love people well. So who are people in your life who are different from you that God is leading you to? Who are the people that you maybe have avoided? Who are the people that you've stopped praying for? And I want you to hear this, is that I'm excited for you guys. I am excited for The Well, because as I was talking with Kevin yesterday, he was just saying that you guys have such a heart and such a passion for the people in your community. And I see it, and I've seen the impact that The Well has in this community, and it's beautiful. And you guys do a fantastic job. You're hungry, and you're ready to see God's love shine in this dark, dark world. It can feel hopeless sometimes, though, right? We can feel defeated sometimes. But friends, when we open our eyes to be aware of the people around us, and when we love people with the power of the Holy Spirit in boldness, and when you move with compassion for the people around you in the name of Jesus, that is when lives are changed. That is when destinies are formed. So this week, my challenge for you is to ask God to make you aware of people. to point people out, to illuminate people in your minds that who you need to go and speak to. Who is God challenging you this week to go and love like Jesus? And then let's go do it. Let's bring people to him. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for today. God, thank you that your word so clearly describes what it looks like for us to love people well. So God, in our hearts today, would you put people into our minds? God, as we walk about this week, would you highlight people in our thoughts, God, that we can just go and love, that we can be bold, and that we can step out in faith knowing that you are with us, knowing that you've given us everything that we need to be able to point people to you, Jesus. God, your Holy Spirit is with us, so give us the strength to be able to go do that. And God, would you allow us to be compassionate to the people that are hard to be compassionate to? Jesus, we can't do this on our own, and we need you. So would you lead us this week as we love people? We pray all these things in your name. Amen. Hey, thank you guys very much for letting me hang out with you. God bless you guys. Thanks for being here. Have a wonderful week. You guys are dismissed. Thank you.